God is good all the time. All the time, God is good. We do welcome you to this service of worship at the United Methodist Church of Kent. In the midst of today's challenging times, we trust in how God is at work for good, and we join in God's work in part by giving our financial support to the work of the church. You can give by texting a gift to the number that you see on the screen, or by typing the website address into any browser. When you're not on full screen, you'll see a give button that will take you directly to our online giving portal. Today, we began a limited form of in-person worship at the 8:30 hour. The service is in the sanctuary and includes elements such as social distancing, wearing a mask, and no singing during the service. You can find all the parameters for the service on our website. This 8:30 in-person service is designed really for people who are not able to access our online worship, which means, of course, that you are not in the target audience. But we do rejoice in being able to provide an opportunity for folks to connect in that way. This 9:30 live stream service, as well as the 10:30 live stream service, will be continuing, of course, through the summer. We are hopeful that we'll be able to add in-person worship here at this 9:30 hour. Also, we hope at the 10:30 hour at some point in the late summer or fall, while at the same time, of course, we will be continuing with the live streaming. In our prayer concerns this Sunday, Ken Wirtz continues in rehab at the Briarwood. Julie Foster is having surgery this week. Dinah Douglas is having ongoing tests. Dave and Cindy Vaughn and Dave and Carolyn Plaskanka are all dealing with health issues. And Roger and Donna Stiller have been in and out of the hospital. Betty Coleman has started hospice care. The church in our district for which we're all praying this week is the Lakemore United Methodist Church. If you have a prayer concern, you can get it to us through Facebook Messenger. It will be lifted up by our intercessory prayer group, or even right now this morning if you can get it to us in time. For our opening scripture, let us hear this verse from Psalm 138. Though I walk in the midst of trouble, you, O Lord, will revive me. You stretch forth your hand to save me. Let us pray. Guide us, O Lord, as we trust in your saving help. Empower us as we would build our lives and our future upon your strength and your eternal promises. And let's continue then with the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We invite you now to join with our worship band leaders in song.
Grace and peace. We invite you to join us and lift your voices to our Lord, to the great Lord that we serve and love. This is another day that the Lord has given us. Let us rejoice and be glad in it, singing our praises to the God of our salvation. So we pour out our praise to you only.
Above every other name,
is the only one that could ever see. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Oh, we live for you. Holy and holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. And holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. And
our first scripture from the Old Testament this morning is a set of readings from the book of Genesis. Last week, we heard the first part of the story of Joseph, one of the 12 sons of Jacob, and how he was sold by his brothers into slavery in Egypt. But after many ordeals and some unusual twists of events, Joseph became the right-hand man of the Pharaoh and supervised a huge project to store up grain in preparation for a coming famine. We pick up the story after the famine had arisen and was affecting the entire area. When Jacob learned that there was grain in Egypt, he said to his sons, "Why do you keep looking at one another? I have heard," he said, "that there is grain in Egypt. Go down and buy grain for us there, that we may live and not die." So 10 of Joseph's brothers went down to buy grain in Egypt. But Jacob did not send Joseph's brother Benjamin with his brothers, for he feared that harm might come to him. Thus the sons of Israel were among the other people who came to buy grain, for the famine had reached the land of Canaan. Now Joseph was governor of the land. It was he who sold to all the people of the land. And Joseph's brothers came and bowed themselves before him with their faces to the ground. When Joseph saw his brothers, he recognized them. But he treated them as strangers and spoke harshly to them. "Where do you come from?" he said. They said, "From the land of Canaan, to buy food." Although Joseph recognized his brothers, they did not recognize him. Joseph also remembered the dreams that he had dreamed about them. He said to them, "You are spies. You have come to see the nakedness of the land." They said to him, "No, my lord, your servants have come to buy food. We are all sons of one man. We are honest men. Your servants have never been spies." But he said to them, "No, you have come to see the vulnerability of the land." They said, "We, your servants, are 12 brothers, the son of a certain man in the land of Canaan. The youngest, however, is now with our father, and one is no more." But Joseph said to them, "It is just as I have said to you, you are spies. Here is how you shall be tested. As Pharaoh lives, you shall not leave this place unless your youngest brother comes here. Let one of you go and bring your brother, while the rest of you remain in prison, in order that your words may be tested, whether there is truth in you, or else, as Pharaoh lives, surely you are spies." And he put them all together in prison for 3 days. On the third day, Joseph said to them, "Do this and you shall live, for I fear God. If you are honest men, let one of your brothers stay here where you are imprisoned. The rest of you shall go and carry grain for the famine of your households and bring your youngest brother to me. Thus your words will be verified and you shall not die." And they agreed to do so. They said to one another, "Alas, we are paying the penalty for what we did to our brother. We saw his anguish when he pleaded with us, but we would not listen. This is why this anguish has come upon us." Then Reuben answered them, "Did I not tell you not to wrong the boy? But you would not listen. So now there comes a reckoning for his blood." They did not know that Joseph understood them, since he spoke with them through an interpreter. He turned away from them and wept. Then he returned and spoke to them, and he picked out Simeon and had him bound before their eyes. Joseph then gave orders to fill their bags with grain, to return every man's money to his sack, and to give them provisions for their journey. This was done for them. The brothers, minus Simeon, then returned to Canaan, but after some time, the grain that they had purchased in Egypt ran out. They convinced their father Jacob that they had to bring Benjamin on the next trip to Egypt, and they came then before Joseph once more to ask again for grain and to retrieve Simeon. We pick up the story with Joseph's instructions to his staff. Then Joseph commanded the steward of his house, "Fill the men's sacks with food, as much as they can carry, and put each man's money in the top of the sack. Put my cup, the silver cup, in the top of the sack of the youngest, with his money, with the grain." And he did as Joseph told him. As soon as morning was light, the men were sent away with their donkeys. When they had gone only a short distance from the city, Joseph said to his steward, "Go follow after the men, and when you overtake them, say to them, 'Why have you returned evil for good? Why have you stolen my silver cup? Is it not from this that my lord drinks? Does he not indeed use it for divination? You have done wrong in doing this.'" When he overtook them, he repeated these words to them. They said to him, "Why does my lord speak such words as these? Far be it from your servants that they should do such a thing. Should it be found with any one of your servants, let him die. Moreover, the rest of us will become my lord's slaves." He said, "Even so, in accordance with your words, let it be. He with whom it is found shall become my slave, but the rest of you shall go free." Then each one quickly lowered his sack to the ground, and each opened his sack. He searched, beginning with the eldest and ending with the youngest, and the cup was found in Benjamin's sack. At this they tore their clothes. Then each one loaded his donkey, and they returned to the city. Judah and his brothers came to Joseph's house while he was still there, and they fell on the ground before him. Joseph said to them, "What deed is this you have done? Did you not know that one such as I can practice divination?" And Judah said, "What can we say to my lord? What can we speak? How can we clear ourselves? God has found out the guilt of your servants. Here we are, then, my lord's slaves, both we and also the one in whose possession the cup has been found." But he said, "Far be it from me that I should do so. Only the one in whose possession the cup was found shall be my slave. But as for you, go in peace to your father." The brothers, however, refused to go, and one of them, Judah, steps forward. Judah said, "Now therefore, please let me remain as a slave to my lord in place of the boy, and let the boy go back with his brothers. For how can I go back to my father if the boy is not with me? I fear to see the suffering that would come upon my father." Then Joseph could no longer control himself before all those who stood by him, And he cried out, "Send everyone away from me." So no one stayed with him when Joseph made himself known to his brothers. He wept so loudly that the Egyptians heard it and the household of Pharaoh heard it. Joseph said to his brother, "I am Joseph. Is my father still alive?" But his brothers could not answer him, so dismayed were they at his presence. Then Joseph said to his brothers, "Come closer to me." And they came closer. He said, "I am your brother Joseph, whom you sold into Egypt. Now do not be distressed or angry with yourselves because you sold me here, for God sent me before you to preserve life. For the famine has been in this land 2 years, and there are five more years in which there will be neither plowing nor harvest. God sent me before you to preserve for you a remnant on earth and to keep alive for you many survivors. So it was not you who sent me here, but God. He has made me a father to Pharaoh and lord over his house and ruler over all the land of Egypt. Hurry and go up to my father and say to him, 'Thus says your son Joseph, God has made me lord over all Egypt. Come down to me and do not delay. You shall settle in the land of Goshen. You shall be near me, you and your children, your children's children, as well as your flocks, your herds, and all that you have. I will provide for you here, since there are five more years of famine to come, so that you, your household, and all that you have will not come to poverty.'" So the entire family moves to Egypt. Then after some time, Jacob dies. And we pick up the end of the story in chapter 50. Realizing that their father was dead, Joseph's brothers said, "What if Joseph still bears a grudge against us and pays us back in full for all the wrong that we did to him?" So they approached Joseph, saying, "Your father gave us this instruction before he died. Say to Joseph, I beg you, forgive the crime of your brothers and the wrong they did in harming you. Now, therefore, please forgive the crime of the servants of the God of your father." Joseph wept when they spoke to him. Then his brothers also wept and fell down before him and said, "We are here as your slaves." But Joseph said to them, "Do not be afraid. Am I in the place of God? Even though you intended to do harm to me, God intended it for good, in order to preserve a numerous people, as he is doing today." And then let us hear this single verse from the New Testament, from Paul's letter to the Romans. "We know that in all things, God works for good for those who love God, who are called according to God's purpose." May God grant us understanding of his holy word.
My hope is in you, Lord.
The sermon this morning is a continuation of a sermon series entitled Answers for Anxious Times, during which we are looking at biblical stories about people in anxious times, which bring important lessons for our lives today. Last week, we considered the first part of the story of Joseph. Today, we're considering the conclusion of that story. Let's be for a moment in prayer. O Lord, may our hearts be open that we might truly hear what you are saying to us today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The story of Joseph is one of the prime biblical examples of a principle that we heard in the New Testament reading from Romans. In all things, God works for good for those who love God. You might wonder whether that principle really holds true in human life, because so often we see bad things happening to good people. We see great wrongs inflicted upon people who are seeking to love God. George Floyd was a prime example of that. He was known for his significant involvement in Christian ministry in a tough neighborhood of Houston called the Bricks. He mentored young people, helped set up church services and a basketball court, engaged in various forms of outreach to the community. He moved in 2018 to Minnesota as a part of a Christian work program. Yet, enormous injustice happened to him. Where in the Bible might we find a story of someone who was not perfect, but who loved God and sought to live faithfully, but to whom enormous injustice happened? A prime example can be found in the story of Joseph. We met Joseph last week in the scripture reading from Genesis 37, where he was 17 years old, and he was basically a good kid. He did have some irritating personality traits, which mightily irritated his brothers, but he had a good heart and he had faith in God. But here's the sequence of what happened to him in the first part of the story that we heard last Sunday. He was beaten up by his brothers because of their resentment towards him and thrown into a pit. He was sold as a slave to a group of foreign traders on the way to Egypt, where he was sold into captivity into the house of a military officer of the Pharaoh. In Egypt, his master's wife falsely accused him of sexual assault. In reality, he had resisted her advances, holding firm to his moral values, but she, in anger, had accused him of wrongdoing. He was thereupon thrown into an Egyptian prison. At one point in prison, he had a prime opportunity for release, but it evaporated. In that instance, Joseph had interpreted a dream for the Pharaoh's cupbearer, or wine steward, who had been in a position right next to Joseph in prison. And when that cupbearer then subsequently was restored to his position with the Pharaoh, he should have put in a good word for Joseph. But as soon as the cupbearer returned to the Pharaoh's court, he promptly forgot all about Joseph. Joseph remained in prison 2 more years. If you had said to Joseph at that point, all things work for good for those who love God, you might not have been surprised if Joseph had replied, since when? Yet, as we noted last week, in spite of that whole sequence of disasters, Joseph kept trusting in God, and he did believe that somehow God was at work through it all. How is it possible, within horrendous circumstances, to believe that in all things, God is at work for those who love God? If we indeed wonder how God is working for good, there's an important prior question that we need to ask. What is the project on which God is working? The natural human tendency is to think that God is working on my happiness. So if things are going badly for me, I wonder why God is not doing God's job. But if Joseph had imagined that God was supposed to be working on his comfort and well-being, he surely would have concluded that God was not doing anything. But what is clear in the book of Genesis, through the whole course of Joseph's time in Egypt, is that God had a far larger and more long-term project than Joseph's immediate well-being. God's project was the well-being of all the people in the region and the destiny of the family of Jacob, because it was through their descendants that God intended to bring the message of God's salvation to the whole world. With that in mind, there were two major problems in the story of Joseph that God was addressing. The first problem was the dislike, distrust, and division among the sons of Jacob, a kind of problem that we continue to see in many ways today. The sons of Jacob were supposed to become the heads of the 12 tribes of Israel. We saw this problem in the first part of the story of Joseph last week. The brothers despised Joseph, but they also squabbled incessantly among themselves. One brother, Reuben, who was the eldest, wanted to just throw Joseph into a pit and then return him to his father. But the other brothers decided to sell Joseph into slavery and did so while Reuben's back was turned. The 12 tribes of Israel were supposed to become one people who would be a vehicle of God's love and good news to the world. At this point, it looked like they were destined to become 12 warring tribes. The other problem was an impending climate disaster, which also sounds familiar. A severe famine was on the horizon. Periodic dry spells were a part of the natural cycle of things in the ancient Near East, but the people would be ill-prepared to handle the magnitude of what was coming at this time. Everyone in Egypt, as well as in the surrounding region, would be seriously threatened. The family of Jacob would not likely survive in those circumstances. In the story of Joseph, God acts powerfully to address these two problems, and in doing so, ensures that God's plan through the people of Israel would continue to unfold. Seen in this light, everything that happens to Joseph begins to make sense. The fact that Joseph ends up in Egypt, the breadbasket of the ancient Near East, and that he ends up in the prison where the cupbearer of the Pharaoh will be temporarily incarcerated, puts Joseph into a position such that he can become known to the Pharaoh of Egypt. When the Pharaoh himself has a mysterious dream, Joseph, now remembered by the cupbearer, is summoned. Pharaoh's dream, which we discussed last week, was a warning from God about the upcoming famine. When Joseph, under God's inspiration, provides the meaning of the dream and recommends that the Egyptians should store up grain in preparation for the dry years, Joseph is appointed to be the right-hand man of the Pharaoh, and he begins to make the necessary preparations throughout Egypt. So while from an earthly perspective, it appeared that one terrible thing after another was happening to Joseph, from a spiritual perspective, it is clear how God was working to put Joseph into a position from which he finally could save the family of Jacob and all Egypt from the oncoming famine. We saw this in the first part of the scripture reading this morning, which described how Joseph's brothers during the famine came down to Egypt because it was there and there only that they were able to find the grain that they needed to survive. At the same time, God was acting to overcome the dislike, distrust, and division among the brothers of Jacob. When the brothers first came to Egypt to buy grain, they did not expect, of course, to see Joseph, and they did not recognize Joseph when he appeared before them, clean-shaven, in Egyptian garb, as the right-hand man of the Pharaoh. Under God's inspiration, Joseph then embarked on a series of actions designed to test his brothers' hearts and lead to a possible, genuine reconciliation. Joseph initially gave them a hard time. The brothers did not understand what was happening, but they sensed that somehow their troubles were a due recompense for what they had once done to their brother Joseph. As they said to each other, "We are paying the penalty for what we did to our brother. We saw his anguish when he pleaded with us, but we would not listen." Reuben had an "I told you so" moment, as he said, "Did I not tell you not to wrong the boy? Now comes the reckoning for his blood." The whole experience of the famine and the time of testing in Egypt was, for the brothers, a chastening one. Joseph did give them grain to take back to their homes. He wanted to help their families. But he continued to press the basic issue of the dislike, distrust, and division among the brothers. He insisted that one of them must remain in captivity in Egypt until the brothers would return again, and he insisted that the next time they must bring along their little brother Benjamin. The brothers, as we'd heard in the scripture reading, left Benjamin with their father, Jacob, because Benjamin was the only remaining son, they thought, of Rachel. The brothers were all sons of Jacob, but they're actually the sons of four different mothers. Six of them were the sons of Leah, two of them sons of Zilpah, two of them sons of Bilhah, and Joseph and Benjamin were the sons of Rachel. With Joseph presumed gone forever, their father, Jacob, had been especially protective of Benjamin and wanted to keep him home. The brothers left Simeon in Egypt. Later, when they had run out of grain again and had to come back to Egypt to buy more grain and to pick up Simeon, they necessarily brought along Benjamin. At that point, Joseph put the brothers to a final test. As we heard in this morning's scripture, he gave them grain, but he secretly had his silver chalice hidden in Benjamin's sack. As the brothers tried to depart, Egyptian soldiers stopped them, and Joseph, still not recognized by the brothers, accused them of stealing the chalice. As the chalice was discovered in Benjamin's sack, Joseph announced that the rest of the brothers could go, but Benjamin would be made a slave in Egypt. It was all a setup designed to test the brothers' hearts. Would they now abandon Benjamin to bondage, just as they had once abandoned Joseph to captivity in Egypt? The brothers refused to go, and Judah stepped forward. Judah was the one who originally had suggested that the brothers should sell Joseph into slavery. Now Judah offered himself to take Benjamin's place, to remain as a slave in Egypt. At that moment, Joseph knew that the hearts of the brothers had changed. He revealed his identity, and the brothers were reconciled. At the end of the story, as we heard, the whole family moved down to Egypt to live on prosperous Delta farmland in the area of Goshen provided by Joseph. The famine passed. There in Egypt, Jacob died. The brothers then wondered whether Joseph had really forgiven and accepted them, or whether he might finish them off now that their father was gone. But Joseph embraced them. The dislike, distrust, and division among the brothers had been overcome. There was now a basic unity, which in spite of multiple imperfections over the years would continue to hold the people of Israel together for centuries to come so that they could receive God's word for humanity and so they finally could become the people out of whom the Messiah would come. At the very end of the story, Joseph considers all that had happened and says to his brothers, "You intended your actions for evil, but God intended it all for good in order to preserve a numerous people as God is doing today." Joseph perceives that in all things, God has been at work for good. God used even the evil intentions of his brothers to sell Joseph into slavery in Egypt, and out of it all, brought about great good. So the story of Joseph is a model of how God works, and it says a great deal to us about how to be receptive and how to recognize God's working in our own lives. The story tells us, first of all, to look for God's purpose. If we see trouble in the world and confront troubles in our own lives and are wondering how it is that God is at work, we need to consider the question, what is the project on which God is working? This kind of perspective was very much at the heart of the Apostle Paul in his thinking when he wrote the verse that we heard from Romans. In all things, God works for good for those who love God. Paul was another prime biblical example of a person who loved God but who hit enormous trouble. He once recounted how many times he had been shipwrecked or beaten or imprisoned, and the list went on and on. Plus, he was dealing with all sorts of troubles in the churches that he was trying to develop. How could he say that in all things, God works for good? He could do so because he had his eye on God's purpose. which was to take the gospel throughout the Roman world. And he could see that in spite of personal discomforts and various setbacks, God's purpose was unfolding. Joseph likewise looked beyond his immediate discomforts and frustrations to the greater purpose of God. Significantly, the verse from Romans ends with the phrase, "who are called according to God's purpose." This leads us to the second key aspect of the story of Joseph and also the story of Paul, that we are called to become a part of God's purpose. Joseph opened himself to God's Spirit and aligned himself with what God was doing so that he became the person through whom God provided the answer to the famine and the person through whom the brothers finally were reconciled. Paul likewise became a central part of God's purpose to take the gospel to the world. Today we are called to join in God's purpose by sharing in the mission of the church and by engaging ourselves in the work of God in our world today. Surely a major example of that right now is the engagement of our church in taking a stand against racism in our society. Last weekend, several members of our church were part of the march in Kent, and on our website, you can find out more about how our church and our conference are taking a stand these days for racial justice. Finally, a key lesson in the Joseph story is to take the long view, trusting that God's goodness will prevail. We easily can get discouraged when we see only troubles and no ready answers. Joseph might have just thrown in the towel when he repeatedly hit one disaster after another. But he took the long view. He had faith that God was leading him towards a positive destiny, and he kept trusting in God. Surely the greatest example of a person of faith taking the long view is Jesus. In the short view, during his journey on earth, he was heading into all sorts of trouble and pain, culminating in his death on a cross. But he knew that ultimately he was heading into an eternal victory, not only for himself, but for all humanity. It is in this context that the story of George Floyd becomes finally not simply a tragedy, but a story of redemption. It is the story of an unjust death that has galvanized the nation into a commitment to change. And for George himself, because of his faith in Christ, it is a story that will continue into a bright and eternal future. So we can affirm today that the scripture is indeed true. In all things, God works for good for those who love God, who are called according to God's purpose. Let us pray. O Lord, guide us as we confront challenges in our own lives and great troubles in the world around us to put our faith in you, even when we cannot fully understand or see the answers yet. Guide us, O Lord, to have that confidence that you are indeed at work for good. Lead us, O Lord, to look for your purpose. Lead us to join in your purpose. And lead us, O Lord, to take the long view, trusting indeed that your goodness will prevail. We thank you, Lord, that you draw us into fellowship with yourself and that you draw us into connection with each other in the life of your church, and that through the church we can indeed be a part of your mission in the world. We reach out to persons this morning who are in times of particular need. We lift up especially Ken Wirtz, Julie Foster, Diana Douglas, Dave and Cindy Vaughn, Dave and Carolyn Pliskanka, Roger and Donna Stiller, and Betty Coleman, praying, O Lord, for your healing and encouraging power to be at work. We reach out, Lord, into our larger world, a world so afflicted with division and pain, world struggling here in our own land with a terrible legacy of racism. We ask, O Lord, that your healing power would be at work. You would guide us to new ways of living together to become the kind of society you intend us to be. We pray, Lord, you would empower us as we reach out into the whole world today. We lift up our fellow United Methodists at the Lakemoor United Methodist Church. Inspire us, O God, as we commit ourselves to your purposes and as we lift our hearts to you in faith, rejoicing in the eternal promise that we have in you. In the name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior, we pray. Amen.
What an assurance to know that our God is working in all things for our good as we continue to love him and to follow his purposes for our lives. This song, we're going to close the service with this song, Good, Good Father, which I encourage you to sing along, affirming the goodness of our Heavenly Father, who's working all things for our good. Amen. You will hear again, and I praise God for the commitment, the ongoing commitment of our entire band that you'll be hearing as you've been in the last few weeks on the background. They're not here with us, but I praise God that they continue in ministry to our church. Let us sing together, affirming the goodness of our Heavenly Father.
Stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night. You tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are.
Our Heavenly Father, you are good, and you are perfect in all of your ways. We praise you for your goodness. We praise you for the purpose that you have for our lives and for the life of your church in a challenging and turbulent world. We praise you that you are in control of all things, that you are God in heaven above all things, that you've created us with and for a purpose. And we praise you for all that you're doing through us and in us. Father, we also confess to you that oftentimes we have lost sight of that. We confess to you that oftentimes we have drifted away from the purposes that you have for us. We have doubted. We have lacked faith. We're sorry for that. We're also thankful that you are a loving God, a God who forgives us, a God who does not remember our iniquities but seeks to reconcile with us, and a God who sustains us in this relationship that we enjoy with you. We pray, Father, that you'd increase our love for you, and that in doing so, we would be closer to you so that we could clearly see the purposes that you're unfolding for our lives. We thank you that you are a good God who's working for us. And we pray, Father, as we head to this new week, as we look ahead, we look at circumstances close to us, and we look around for circumstances that affect us all, nationwide and worldwide, we pray for your mercy, for your kindness, for your healing. Pray that you be with us, with your body, the body of Christ, that we might continue to grow and abound in the love that we have for you, and that in doing so, we might be more like your Son, Jesus, in the ways in which we relate to one another, to others, and to this world that you've created. And for all of that, even through these challenges, we will continue to give you thanks, to give you honor, and to give you all the glory that is due to you. And we pray all this, trusting in you, in your faithfulness, in your goodness. In Christ's name, amen. Grace and peace be with you. Have a blessed week.